The FF Dynasty presents Married to the Game. For your pleasure.
We got a fun 11 through 15 here. These guys are all kind of interchangeable. I feel like you could put 15 at the top or, you know, 11 and 12, swap them around kind of any which way you want to do. But we're gonna discuss them at length because that's kind of what we do.
Yeah. And try and get our order solidified. Let's get into it.
All right. So we got our average list here. Kicking it off at number 11 is Stephon Diggs, whether you like it or not. So let's first get into like some kind of pros, cons, a little bit of breakdown on Stephon Diggs here, and then we'll eventually get to the spot where we're arguing about maybe who should have been above or below Stephon Diggs here.
Right.
So who wants to kick us off?
Well, I know Stephon Diggs is both of you guys like love fest for Stephon Diggs. I mean, I love some Stephon
Man
Diggs
Crush
as
Monday.
Well.
The love is real.
Give it to me, Big Co. What you got? Why is Stephon Diggs so awesome?
Well, let's just look at it like this. We talked a lot in the preseason and the offseason about Diggs. I did and tried to. Casey and I's love for Diggs is just hard to hold back.
We put out some redraft rankings, and we had Diggs pretty high, and some dude came at us on Facebook about why is Stephon Diggs so high, and Big Co basically wrote him a dissertation. So just say that.
Well, he was asking me for our.
He gave him a great honest answer. He told him why.
He
had nothing back.
What metric?
Oh yeah, I would like to know the metric that was used to put Stephon Diggs as a third round pick.
Metric machine's broken, Bubba.
I said,
watch good old fashioned football.
I said our metric machine is broken, and I just had to watch. It didn't take long. Week one, he goes 7 for 93, 2 touchdowns.
Boom.
That was the home game against the Saints. Everybody remembers it. It was the Vikings coming out party on offense. And then the next week,
Randy Moss blew the horn to open that game
right,
up. And Stephon Diggs was doing Randy Moss work on the field.
He was crushing. The next week, you got Bradford goes at Pittsburgh. The whole ship comes burning down, and it's the end of the world. And then back home the next week, 8 for 173 and 2 touchdowns. So in the first two.
With some Case Keenum.
So week two. Diggs goes 2 for 27, he busts out the first week, crushes it, number one receiver on the week to open the season. Then Bradford's dragging his leg around there in Pittsburgh, and the whole team gets shut down.
Oh, it was awful.
It was terrible looking. And then Case Keenum comes in there, saves the day, and he blows back up again. That was the reason that I was trying to push Diggs higher up in the list than what he had, necessarily maybe earned because of the – the quarterback situation that I mentioned coming back. Everybody knows it came, Bradford got traded into the Vikings last year. He had 2 weeks before the season started. And that was my thing. I was like, give Bradford and Diggs some time to get on the page here. And they were crushing it. Didn't last very long. And then Keenum comes in, who had mediocre at best success in the NFL to that point, which he had played under Jeff Fisher. Mm. And, not many people were thriving under Jeff Fisher in the last 10 years.
So. Please don't let Jeff Fisher back into the league. Like, maybe give him some kind of assistant coordinator job, but do not let him coach an NFL team,
no
please.
More, Fisher gets no more talk from us.
Yikes.
Diggs just didn't take long to show how explosive he is. He's the red zone problems or lack of the red zone production that was the main thing that was Casey was trying to keep, kind of knocking him on.
Wasn't knocking him, but that was my offseason reservation.
That
of
was
not
the reservation.
Having him super high up in the rankings.
Was the lack of touchdowns.
Was that there
well, that
was a
due for a positive
of,
regression, though.
Yeah. True.
I got a drink. If you say positive or negative regression, you got to drink.
Any regression.
Well, there's not many. Not sure that talk going to come out of here. But that Diggs did not take – he had 4 touchdowns in 3 weeks. Didn't take long for him to show that he was a game breaker. Then a couple of weeks stretch where he's nicked up and the offense is trying to figure out what's going on. Thielen's coming on strong. Case Keenum's not finding him there for a couple of weeks. But the whole reason that I love Diggs so much is because of that top quality game that he's able to put out. Good for the guys that can go out there and get you 6 for 60 sometimes, and good for the guys that go out there and blow up sometimes. But like Diggs blowing up is like the top of the 8 for 173 and 2. Like that's Antonio Brown type game. You know, there's not many games, there's not many players that can get you that that fantasy week winner type score. When Diggs goes 8 for 173 and 2 touchdowns, like you're probably going to win that week. And of course I'm cherry picking. That's his best game of the season. I get that. Those were some of the games that he showed flashes of that as a 23-year-old man. He just didn't have the top 5 pedigree that Amari Cooper did, but he's played no less quality football as Amari Cooper. He's just been a little bit less healthy than Amari Cooper over his first 2 years. I'm a big believer in Diggs. You do have to put up with a little bit of injury here and there, but the kid is he's a young dude, but he's just put up top tier type performances, and he showed it again this year.
Try to not get too caught up in any sort of like it's some soft tissue kind of injuries and things happen, man. He's
just the NFL. We know about injuries.
Look at Keenan Allen. I mean, obviously you can say what you want. They weren't really soft tissue injuries, and some of them were like more fluky than others, but
very fluky.
You know, it's just that's a tough thing to really to argue about. I mean, if that's your personal preference, you don't want any guys with any sort of questionable. I mean, this was Alshon Jeffrey's whole career was, oh, well, I don't like him because of soft tissue. I mean, he played every game this year.
Right.
It's just, it happens. Exactly. Things happen. Like, you know, but the thing with Stephon Diggs is that he's a Landry kind of player. Like he is Jarvis Landry, except he's got a whole nother gear and a whole nother level that he can take it to.
Yeah.
So he can be a take the top off the defense crazy deep threat, which we've seen already. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with being a Jarvis Landry, even if that was his ceiling.
Right.
Like, just running dig routes, shallow digs, and deeper crosses across the field there over and over again, that's fine. Like, I want Stephon Diggs running across the field on a shallow, because he crushes yards after the catch. Like, you get the balls in, you get ball in Diggs' hands and hold your breath. If you aren't on top of him immediately, there's a good chance that he can take that thing to the house at any particular point in time. And then once you can develop those kind of things going on of crossing routes and other routes, you can then, you know, work off of those and get your deep routes in and all that kind of stuff. Obviously, you do have a little bit of a Thielen action there. Keenum comes in. Thielen's his boy. They get a little magic happening.
You can see rapport between quarterback and receiver. And anytime there's a quarterback change, you have to look for where the targets are going to go.
Who the guy's going to be. So it looked like it was Thielen. Like you said, Diggs is battling a little bit of a groin injury, which, you know, obviously can vastly affect your burst and all that kind of stuff. And that's the reason why you like Stephon Diggs, is because he can run that route and get to the top of it and then explode.
Right.
Where there's just no, you can't cover him. And it's just like, well, when you really break it down and you look at it, Antonio Brown wasn't Antonio Brown for a while. And this guy's...
That's exactly what I said.
I'm not saying that he's Antonio Brown by any means. So don't, you know, misinterpret the words that are coming out of my mouth. But he's a similar style of player that could be that kind of player.
Exactly. Let me take this
for
1 second.
Which is why he's at 11 right now.
1 second.
For us in these rankings.
Before you get rolling over there, Jay Wayne, let me jump and piggyback that. Because that was one of the exact points I made. And that's what I said to the dude that hit us up on Facebook saying, hey, why do you have Diggs ranked so high? I was like, dude, and I just Diggs just turned 24 in late November, November 29th. So like this happened before he was even 24 years old. Like what you just said. Antonio Brown was not Antonio Brown the first 3 years of his career.
Not saying that he's going to be Antonio Brown.
Not saying he is. Not saying he has Antonio Brown's work ethic, or not saying he has Big Ben or any of those good things, or Haley drawing up the exit.
Before you go any further, let me just interrupt you. Who's been this guy's quarterback the entire time he's been in the
who's
league?
Who's been throwing him the ball?
You give him Big Ben, he could very well put up Antonio Brown numbers.
Antonio
Brown does not exist without Big Ben.
The wide receiver position.
Not like he does.
The wide receiver position is the most dependent. That's why they're divas.
It's codependent.
It is the most dependent position in
takes
sports.
Two to tango.
It takes more than two. It takes the offensive line to stand up for just a second to give the quarterback a minute. It takes the quarterback's throw to be nearly accurate enough, and then the wide receiver has to do his thing.
Right.
There's a lot of things that have to happen.
It's like an orgy going on here.
There's a lot of things that has to happen.
Tango.
That's why you see when Peyton Manning's in his prime and when Aaron Rodgers is healthy, those types, and Drew Brees, those types of players where Drew Brees spreads it around to everybody and puts five guys into top 30. But, like, Peyton Manning would have two players into top 10 PPR points for his career. You know, Aaron Rodgers is putting Jordy Nelson and those kind of guys, Devontae Adams and Randall Cobb.
Randall Cobb stays healthy. He could easily be up in there.
You get that quarterback who's putting the ball where it needs to be when it needs to be there, and you have wide receivers. Take nothing away from Jordy Nelson. I love Randall Cobb. I love Devontae Adams. Look, but, you know, like those,
Deshaun comes in, Will Fuller,
exactly.
Hopkins, Eaton.
Quarterback makes the wide receiver more often than wide receiver makes the quarterback. And the
backup running back Diggs, is eating with Deshaun Watson.
Diggs has been crushing with now he's got we like Case Keenum because he doesn't quit and he drives forward. But like, who is Case Keenum?
Right.
He's you know, a prolific college quarterback, but on, you know, playing subpar defenses every week.
And Bradford looked like he was, you know, like you said, he got a little time with Diggs in the offseason. He got traded right before last season. They looked like them boys were about to be on pace to be a solid connection all year. He liked him last year when he was healthy. And it just didn't happen to, you know, work out that way on either one of those guys' ends.
Well, that was my thing about the year before was Bradford missed many of good connections with Diggs. There was plenty of balls that were out there in the 2016 game tape where Bradford just over or under threw Diggs, streaking down the middle of the field, like you're saying, with that extra gear. And I think the sky's the limit for Diggs. And, I you know, we'll get into this. The next couple guys down these rankings are pretty much interchangeable.
Yeah.
So it's not really, I'm like, hey, you got to take Diggs as your number 11th wide receiver. It's just.
But you probably got him in the top 15. Exactly. That we're about to talk about.
You probably need to have him in the top 15.
The
for
potential
sure.
for what Diggs could develop into, I feel like, is what put me to rank him as my number
11. For what you've already seen, and then the next level potential is why I also had him at 11 in this particular setting, because there's a Landry kind of floor here, I believe, and then, you know, catch-wise and short area targets and all that stuff-wise, and then there's a whole nother level that he could really take it to. So, Mike Randall, the answer is no. You can't find, nobody can finally admit that Stephon Diggs is overrated, because he's not.
Why would you say
that? The answer is absolutely no. Anthony what's this guy's name?
Amico?
Anthony Amico, like, get off the A-dot, bro. Who cares? Who cares if this guy's turning into Jarvis Landry? Jarvis Landry's been great.
Like, yeah.
Quit hating. Stephon Diggs is not turning into Jarvis Landry. If Stephon Diggs needs to come down and run some shallower routes so Case Keenum can get him the ball, that's fine.
Right. I don't care how he does it. Get this guy the ball. He's not overrated, and I don't give a shit about the A-dot ever.
Right. Yeah.
I don't care.
When you're crushing Yak, it really doesn't matter at all.
He's a good player.
Right. I mean, he's a great route runner. What I love about him, he's only 6 feet, 195 pounds, but he's basically a big dude. Like, he plays like a big man. Like, he's the hands for the most part are amazing. He goes up and makes contested catches. Like, he's making plays on the ball like he's bigger than 6 feet tall, and he'll secure
plays
that
with
catch.
A chip on his shoulder.
Right, he plays with that feisty Jarvis Landry.
He wants to be the best.
Feisty, run you over and you know, just go at everybody. But he has that extra level, and he can go up in the air and make ridiculous plays. And like his. He's good at confusing corners. Like, he's got a savviness about him. Like, I was watching them play the Packers, and he was basically running a post route, but he started off inside, and then he, like, switched to the outside and then switched back in, and you could barely even see him. He just kind of, like, weaved around the corner, and the corner didn't know what was happening, and he cut to the outside like he's going to run a corner and then post it up. And
yeah. Well, that's
a great ball is delivered, and he makes a huge touchdown play. And it's like, to see him have this like savviness but still be able to go up in the air and crush these contested catches. Now, he does have the occasional concentration drop. You know, he dropped 4 out of 68 catchable balls, but that's going to happen from time to time. But, I mean, and then you throw a zone at him, he's definitely finding the soft spot, and that, it's hard to argue against him at all. The only thing that
you're eventually going to have to be rolling double coverage his way, and then it's like, well, then you got Thielen on the other side of you, who probably benefited from that at some point. You know,
absolutely.
I don't have the
and those were two good complementary. Those are good complementary skill sets for both of those guys.
Yeah, absolutely. They're kind of one just two exactly. That's a solid point.
It's just the soft tissue issues. That's the only thing that you'd ever think about, because he's missed 5 games in 3 years. He's been limited or like a decoy in those other ones because he's had 2 groin strains, which really can impact your burst. Yeah. Like you already said, hamstring, knee, and hip. Like, he's had 5 different strains. They're all strains. So these are all muscle issues. They're all
soft
tissue.
He's an explosive player and probably needs to figure something out in that regard. And I'm assuming that will eventually happen and this will stop happening.
Yeah.
Well, sure. Well, you know, let me just throw this in there. You got 13.88 points per game, all right, with Stephon Diggs. That's super solid. There's a big cluster there in the 13 range. Marvin Jones, Robert Woods, Mike Evans, Brandon Cooks, those types of players. But Stephon Diggs goes out with a groin injury with 1.4, then misses a couple games, you know. Robert Woods missed a couple games. Sterling Shepard missed a couple games. Juju Smith-Schuster missed a couple games. Odell Beckham's been out for the year since week 5. Like, injuries happen. You don't know if you're going to plug in Stephon Diggs in the week where he's – anybody can get hurt at any time in the NFL. But those weeks where Diggs is in there being healthy, he's been in the top – he's ranked 13th in the league in points per game. And at 23 years old, doing most of that damage at 23 years old, Case Keenum, a guy that was thrown on the scrap heap as a quarterback. Like, the quarterback situation in Minnesota has been as volatile as any quarterback situation in the league. And good for Diggs and good for Thielen.
He's had to go with both. Teddy, with Bradford.
Teddy did look good there for a little bit, but he was a young man trying to figure out his thing in the NFL, too. Bradford had been good before, but, I mean, in between knee injuries. And, you know, it's just the wide receivers, like – look at what DeAndre Hopkins did last year and the year before that. Like, he had an up and down bump. DeAndre Hopkins had a big bump in the road trying to figure out who the heck was going to get him the ball last year in Houston.
Yeah.
You know? So, like, these
Case Keenum.
Right. Case Keenum couldn't get him the ball barely, you know? So, these guys, these young studs that have the superstar potential that are just trying to make it through until the quarterback situation gets figured out, but are also at the same time still able to put up back-end wide receiver one, high-end wide receiver two numbers at 23, 24 years old, put them on your dynasty team and be happy about it.
Right.
Yeah, agreed. And you saw he didn't play all the games this year, but you saw the touchdowns go up. What do you have, 8 touchdowns this year?
Crushed.
Like, and one of the best red zone target percentages, I think, or something along those lines.
He's only 23rd in red zone targets, but he's super efficient. He's 7th in receptions.
Right, and the stat I saw that said of the wide when the quarterback is targeting a certain receiver, Stephon Diggs blew the doors off. He was a number one for the quarterback rating. So when his quarterbacks, whoever it was, Case Keenum or Bradford this year, whenever the quarterback was targeting Stephon Diggs in the red zone, the QBR was like 128, and it was 10 points higher than the second place guy, which I think was Jason Witten, and then somebody else popped up on that list, maybe DeAndre Hopkins. But I mean, Stephon Diggs was working in the red zone and the confined area, putting in work.
Yeah,
and he's underrated.
He should be able to, with all that overrated short area burst and all that quickness. Like, he should be effective in the red zone, which was the only thing that was scaring me off in the off season. The only reason I hesitated to put him up this high to start the season last year. But I know we're getting a little long winded here on Diggs. We got love affairs on him. I know.
Well, real quick. So, like, you talked about his touchdowns. I mean, I saw several instances where on the goal line, they're lining him up out wide and throwing him back shoulder fades like a big man. Back to the point about him playing big in the air. Like, throw my dude a back shoulder fade on the end zone. Like, that doesn't get much easier for that if you're capable of pulling that off.
Right.
There's no easier way to get my dude a touchdown.
Yeah.
Like, you're seeing that. And you're right. He had 8 this year. And I love he's got that Emmanuel Sanders quality where he's not just going to try and run under a ball and risk not catching it. Like, he's going to lay all out to make this catch, even if it's going to stop at the 2-yard line, you know, and that's and his laying out quality may lead to some of that soft tissue stuff, but that you got to brush that aside, and you got to
love
that
competitive spirit.
I'll take the gamer all day long.
So me and Big Co had Diggs at 11. I know you had Tyreek Hill at 11.
Yeah.
Let's maybe take a break.
Yeah.
And we'll get to your reason for maybe having Tyreek Hill higher than Stephon Diggs, which, again, I don't think anybody
flipping coins
arguing
here,
sure,
I guess.
Well, sure, I can't argue with you. However you want to chop these guys up. So.
Yeah. Well, let's take a break. We'll be back with some Tyreek Hills.
All right. Welcome back. You can find us on Twitter at the FF Dynasty. We all have individual handles. I'm at IMC Myers. You can find Jason at J Wayne's World. And you can find Big Co at Dynasty Big Co. Let's get right back into Tyreek Hill. He's our average number 12 ranked receiver right now. When we went to break, we alluded to that. Jay Wayne had Hill above Diggs. Me and Big Co had Diggs at 11. So what you got for us, Big Dog?
Tyreek Hill, a.k.a. the Cheetah.
A.k.a.
the Millennium Falcon.
We're talking about...
A.k.a. Warp Speed.
We're talking about Cordarrelle Patterson, right?
Oh, yeah. Cordarrelle Patterson 3.0.
Just kidding. Never said that.
Well, I mean, I love Diggs as much as the next guy. I really love Tyreek Hill. I've liked him for a long time. I don't know why. It's hard to split hairs here between 11 and 12. I just let me go in on this guy and see if I can sway you at all. But
I mean, before you start, I don't. I could I could go Tyreek Hill at 11, no problem, and Diggs at 12, no problem.
It's so hard to choose. And if I was on the clock with my hands tied and all these dudes are on the board, I might just have to take Jarvis Landry. Like, I don't know. I can't rank him over those guys.
Right.
I might just have to take those 15 points, you know? But but Tyreek Hill and Diggs are so attractive. But really, man, Tyreek Hill, like, this dude has only been in the league 2 years, and he's basically graduated right in front of our eyes from gadget player to actual wide receiver, and that's getting scary. Because he's so electric from so many different aspects on the field, but, like, he looks like he's learning the wide receiver position. Like, I mean, I see him floating and moving around in zones from one open spot to the next. You know, I don't know that he was necessarily doing that in his rookie year. He's putting double moves on dudes. He's virtually unstoppable on a comeback route. He's lining up all over the field, left, right, the slot, in the backfield, jet sweeps. Like, it doesn't matter. This dude's all over the place. And Andy Reid is manufacturing him short touches to go with these deep bombs. And, like, it's raised his floor.
Absolutely.
And, like, the ceiling is the roof with this guy.
Right.
So just as it is with Diggs.
When we did our mock draft, Big Co ended up last year in the fourth round. That was Big Co's pick.
He reached up.
And we thought. And we talked about it for a little while. And that was my concern, but also my little bit of a peace of mind. I don't know what the word I'm looking for is that I did believe that Andy Reid knows that what this guy can do, and that you can count on a guy like Andy Reid to scheme him well to get the ball in his hands. Obviously Aaron Rodgers has control of the Packers for the most part,
exactly.
But Mike McCarthy scheming Ty Montgomery the correct way was my concern with that. And, you know, we didn't get to see that play out for very long, but anyway, that was kind of my,
But the faith that we had in Andy Reid to do and
to scheme him properly and get the ball in his hands.
We are the first 2 or 3 weeks of the season, there wasn't any team more electric than the Chiefs. And it was that, you know, Andy Reid, maybe career still undefeated off of a bye. You give Andy Reid a little bit of time, he's going to tweak some offense and he's going to put things on the field, the X's and O's wise, that nobody's ever seen before. And between Kelce and Kareem Hunt and Tyreek Hill, these guys were all going in different directions in every single play, and nobody knew where they needed to be on defense to stop these guys. And they're, you know, Tyreek Hill, Diggs, I was talking about the upper end ability to put points on the board, and, like, Tyreek Hill had a 6-for-185 in 2 games, which is right up there with what I was talking about with Diggs, that ability to be the best of the best in a week or two of the season and help you win you a week. There's still some, you know, Tyreek Hill gave you a 2-for-64, but he threw in that touchdown. That was a big play. That's kind of like that DeSean Jackson element that he's going to bring you. But the part that he brings you above one of those boom or bust weekly guys is his toughness. He will run the ball. They will throw it to him short, and if he makes you miss, he's gone. He does punt return. He made his name as a rookie starting to get the punt returns. I love the guy that's super fast and he's tough. And I don't think anybody in the league is faster and tougher combination than maybe Tyreek Hill. He's fastest guy on the field every week that he plays.
Yeah.
And, you know, there was a couple of games, you know, I remember there was a game where I was playing against Tyreek Hill 1 week this past season, and he just got tackled like 2 or 3 games. It might have been Monday night game or something. He just gets tackled on his face a couple plays in a row, and I'm like, fantastic. He's out of the game. He's in concussion protocol. Not that I want anybody to get hurt.
He came up a little gimpy, a little bit.
Not that you want anybody to get hurt, but, you know, you're like, all right, maybe he'll leave me alone for a couple of plays. You know, just get out for the rest of the game here and let me squeak by with a victory. But he keeps coming back, and he keeps coming in, and he's just shakes off a concussion better than any, you know, he's just he's just not afraid to stick his nose in there and keep taking punches. And I admire his toughness. And one thing that you said really, really perfect there, Jay Wayne, is he is graduating from a gadget player to I'm a legit player in this league. And, you know, my man's 23 years old, 5'10", 185 out of West Alabama, came from,
looks,
you know,
big though, just like you were talking about Diggs. Same kind of, all these guys are, it's funny that all these guys that we're about to talk about, somewhat similar, like, builds and skill sets.
The crossing route crushers.
Really. Yeah.
Just send any of these dudes on a crossing route, done deal. Yeah. 5, 6, 10 yards, you're good.
Well, what I believe Hill has worked himself into here is a very safe player to be drafting. And I hammered this home every single week in the offseason last year coming into Dynasty Startup Drafts, was just don't blow it. First, second, third, fourth round picks. Be safe. And, you know, obviously Jarvis Landry's become as safe as it can get. Stephon Diggs, you think, oh, well, maybe he's his injuries and stuff. There's a couple of games, like a couple games here where Diggs didn't blow the doors off, but there's a couple games where he does, you know, raise the roof. So, like you were talking about, his ceiling is extremely high, and with his floor being, you know, driven up by Andy Reid's not going anywhere. Tyreek Hill's not.
You know,
not
you had good. A part in the season where, like, just like every season, everyone's like, well, Andy Reid's the worst. Yeah. Like, there's no adjustment, blah, 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 blah. You know, I don't know what happened in the middle of the season. They had a lot of injuries on that offensive line.
Well, they had a five-game cushion, right. And
injuries all around.
Just to get started, the year he comes off, Diggs blew up in the first couple weeks of the season and then took a couple weeks off with a groin injury. Tyreek Hill did the same thing. He goes 7 for 133 and a touchdown to get started, but then he goes 4 for 43, a good game, 5 for 77 with a touch, but then he takes 3 weeks in a row where he doesn't even get 10 points. Yeah, it's like 5 for 35, 4 for 60, 5 for 34, and then 2 for 38.
To 10, though.
You know, it's just like those.
Could
those,
have had a punt return in there.
Those games could have.
He did
have one punt return in there. That's
well,
funny.
Then again, boom. That's just touchdown. another thing uh-huh. that is just elevates.
Saved your day.
Elevates what Tyreek Hill can do for you. And
right.
Whether maybe he's not having a great day receiving. And this is a guy, you know, he can return a kick or a punt. And this is a guy who, at Oklahoma State, this guy was a running back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He obviously has some trouble, goes to West Alabama or whatever, kind of, you know, turns a little bit more into a receiver. And so really, like, the receiving game overall, like, when he was at Oklahoma State, he wasn't a receiver. He was a great receiving back.
Right.
And he had a lot of receiving yards and catches, like 31 catches in his 12 games there, but which is a solid number, and touchdowns to boot. But
well, he's just crazy at scoring touchdowns any which way you carve right. it up. I was watching him on the top 100 because he made the top 100 list his rookie 100. Year. Marquette King,
the
Raiders
punter.
He goes, and I quote about Tyreek Hill. He goes, quote, "It's always like the ugly people are the best players. It's crazy, man." And I knew he was going to be real good. Right. He goes, and they cut to him like with this dumb look on his face. They hammed it up pretty well. He's like, "Oh, I'm just playing," but really, like, King is just mad because Tyreek took a punt to the house on him.
Yeah,
he's taken 3 to the house in 2 years. One kickoff last year as well. Smartly, they didn't let him return kicks this year. He had no kickoff return yardage at all this year, and it was just the occasional punt.
Yeah,
but like, he's gonna get you that occasional return touchdown.
Right.
It's crazy. And he, another thing that King was saying, he's like Mike Vick in that 2004 Madden.
Yeah,
he's just so fast, and you can run around with him all day, and he never gets tired.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wow, it's crazy. And just to speak to your ugly people point. I used to think the same thing about. I used to be real into snowboarding. I fancied myself a decent snowboarder for a little while, and I always thought that like the guys who were like really good at snowboarding, like this was probably circa 2005-06, were so smug because they weren't getting any puss. So they just went out there and crushed and you know went home. Got back up the next morning, went back out and snowed. Them boys weren't good timing it out there.
That's
just
funny.
Ugly.
That's funny.
Ugly mugs.
Man. That's funny. I went through my little phase where I was in college and I used to enjoy getting in fisticuffs just for fun. And I used to
my game. Dick slap is my game.
Fisticuffs?
Fisticuffs?
Dick slap is my game. Sorry.
I used to enjoy talking shit to people about that. And then I'd be like, well, I got a lot more to lose than you do because I'm a much better looking man. You know, I'm not going to fight you for free. Put $100 on it. What if you bruise me up pretty good? I got the ladies calling me.
Let's dance, Ben Affleck.
All right. What else you got on Tyreek over there?
So I got a little bit more. So I went back and watched some of
his
games.
I got a little bit
yeah.
more. I got more.
What can't else? Come in here and tell you why I like this guy more than Diggs with nothing. I can't come to the table with nothing here.
I'm liking it. Let's
yeah.
go.
So I went back and watched some games from this past season. One of the ones, there's really just a play that stuck out to me here is week 15 versus the Chargers. They throw up this graphic of Casey Hayward and how over the past two seasons, he's first in interceptions,
yeah.
first in passes defended,
yep.
and fifth in opponent's completion percentage. And literally the very next play after that graphic, Tyreek Hill absolutely roasts him. Like, left him in the dust for
yeah.
a 64-yard touchdown. And the best part of that play is the move that Hill gave him right off the line of scrimmage. Like, he just slow-played that go route, gave him a little hesitation move, and it made him second guess. Like, the corner just was just a slight hesitation at all, and it was over at that point.
That's good speed out of Hayward.
And, right, and he wasn't anywhere close to Tyreek Hill. Tyreek Hill put up the deuces.
Right.
He gets to celebrate by himself in the end zone because no one's near him.
That's probably my favorite thing. That when he smokes you and those deuces come up, or like last year they smoked somebody maybe on a – I don't remember what play it was, but then him and
DeAnthony
Thomas ran down there,
and then
boys were
high
fiving before they got in the end zone.
Yeah,
like, you know, little DeAnthony Thomas is a fast little dude
too. Yeah, he is too.
But it's crazy that basically what's happening with him is like it's like you know, D-Jax and like Will Fuller, like I kind of have that speed where it's just like. It's just a matter of time before the corner's just really biding his time and really just praying that he doesn't end up on SportsCenter because he got roasted.
Right, which is why that comeback route works so well.
Right.
And then, like, my point really was that he's showing little subtle nuances on getting off the line of scrimmage.
Right.
You know, like, he's becoming a wide receiver. He's not just this gadget player.
Yeah.
He scored 12 touchdowns as a rookie, follows that up with 8 this year.
Yeah.
But he added 14 more catches and almost 600 more receiving yards.
Yeah.
So, and this was with being held out week 17. So this is with one game where he wasn't hurt. They just were like, we don't need this game. Let's rest you. And we're put that game on record or pause right now because we're recording right before this
Chiefs game.
This Chiefs game. So, you know, they're saving him for this. It's about to be exciting to watch. But, I mean, 15th in the league in yak right behind Antonio Brown and just ahead of Michael Thomas. I could keep going. But.
Yeah, but I think one thing that you guys both mentioned at some point, and I'm going to just hop
bring
in
it back around.
Yeah, I'm going to hop in there too, is there does seem to be a toughness about that. You see him, you see him limp off the field and you're like, oh shit, he's hurt. You know, it's these guys with the quick twitch kind of stuff with the ankles and the hamstrings, just like we talked about with Diggs and stuff like that. But he always comes back.
Yep.
Yeah.
Always comes back.
It makes you feel real good about your investment. And speaking of investment, before we get off of Tyreek Hill, I want to throw it up to Jay Wayne, because all off season long, I was not really necessarily this season, but the season before, when Tyreek Hill became a thing, I was like, you know, you could sell high. And then came into this offseason, I was like, you could still sell high. It's higher than I told you to sell before, because Tyreek Hill was a gadget player. And not that the Cordell Patterson reference came from a Matt Kelly segment that we were making fun of, but I took Tyreek Hill at 412 in our mock it up before we fuck it up. So I expected him to do well.
Yeah.
But did not expect to see Tyreek Hill in my top 10 to 15 PPR rankings in a draft startup scenario.
Right.
I expected him to do well. I did not expect him to go out and make me feel as good about him as I do Diggs and Landry and Brandon Cooks and these kind of cats. So hats off to you.
Hats
off to you for not selling.
Hit the gong on that one.
And riding it out and it working out, because a lot of times it doesn't.
Yeah.
But Tyreek Hill has gone and transcended into another layer now, where he is a proven NFL player. And
he's an entity at this point.
He's an entity.
And his value probably can't go down.
He's
even if he got hurt.
And it's just, you know, it's an interesting, like, there's so many flashes in the pan, and it's always it's always, you know, you're always weighing whether you should sell or not. Guys like me and Big Co probably sells the most out of anybody here. I'm kind of in the middle, and Jay Wayne's a much more of a firm hold kind of guy.
Yeah. Not getting out of these mittens.
You know, if somebody wants to blow my doors off, I'll sell them, especially, but you just never know, like Keelan Cole right now.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
Like, right now, he's pretty hot.
Hold him.
He's fast. He could make even more noise throughout the playoffs here, which is even better. Everyone can see him. If they can see how fast he is, and he can rebound and get healthier, you know, all those kind of things. You just never know. And it's just always like, you could be like, oh, well, you have to sell this guy. You have to sell this guy. And it's like, I mean, you probably should, if you're playing kind of like the stock market kind of game that's, you know, a lot of people like to play in Dynasty Fantasy Football, just because you're trying to gain your value from a guy that you got off the waiver wire.
Exactly.
But, you know, you can absolutely 100% be rewarded from just being stubborn and holding, and you can absolutely be rewarded from or burned by holding, you know.
Sure. Exactly. The flashes in the pan, they are a many. And Tyreek Hill's his progression as a receiver and his toughness that keeps him on the field, you can just see that there's nothing at this point that's going to take him backwards as an NFL player. It's all up to him now as if he wants to go and get better and try to learn his craft.
But yeah.
As being the fastest player on the field, usually the fastest player on the field is not anywhere close to being the toughest.
Yeah. Well, like you've had
plenty of... And it's a good combination out of Tyreek Hill here.
You've had plenty of guys who kind of did what Tyreek Hill did. He was doing some stuff in the pass game on long plays. He was returning kicks and returning punts. And there's a lot of those guys, for whatever reason, if you looked at the metrics probably of whatever these stats and all that come together, a lot of those guys probably... didn't make it, didn't ascend to the stardom that, you know, like Percy Harvin is like one of the only ones who I can recall who had the kind of...
That was,
you know,
going to do that, it that if it wasn't for injury.
Right. You know, but then you get your Cordarrelle Pattersons and those type of guys who, you know, everyone immediately wants to compare these guys to. And it's like, oh, he was a bust. Look what happened. And you got to get rid of him. And it's just like, you got to separate those things. You can't, you can't look at those things and just say because, well, you know, it didn't happen for these couple of guys. It just can't happen. Like, you just never know.
Right.
Yeah, Tyreek must be smart, man, because he's learning, you know, he's learning what Andy Reid wants him to do, and he's doing his own thing. And it's like, and one last thing that doesn't give me, you know, any reservation about putting him up this high is that I like his current QB situation. I like Alex Smith's ability, you know, to produce for him. He's still got a really high ceiling, but then he's got this Patrick Mahomes cat waiting in the wings.
Who just has...
Who could potentially unlock even more potential for this guy, maybe?
Well, you know, you don't know what
get ahead of myself.
You don't know what the rest of Mahomes' game's like, but you do know for a fact that he could throw it as far down the field as Tyreek Hill probably needs him to throw it down the field.
Right, maybe, you know? Farther. Like, this might be like a match made in heaven.
You just had Tlaib come off that last game and be like, you know, if there's one thing about Mahomes, that dude's arm is, you know, phenomenal. Like, that the length on a ball that he can just snap off there and throw down the field is incredible.
I think it just popped up on Roto World that the Chiefs are open to trading Alex Smith. So
pretty
sure that Mahomes is starting the season on week one.
And, why would they put that out right here when Alex Smith's about to freaking play a game?
Well, I don't think it's any secret. There's a contract and all that other stuff. And you got this guy behind you who, you know.
And I guess he's got all the motivation to get some money by getting.
Right. Somebody's going to pay him a ton of money.
Oh, yeah. Tons of teams out there need Alex Smith.
All right. Well, that'll wrap up the 12th spot in our rankings. Let's go ahead and take a break here. And we'll be
back with lucky number 13.
Yeah. For your pleasure. All right, we're back. Welcome to the Nasal Fantasy Football Hour. You can find us on Twitter at the FF Dynasty, at IMC Myers, at Dynasty Big Co, at Jay Wayne's World. Let's keep going with these rankings. We got who's next on the docket at 13? We got Jarvis Landry.
But he wears number 14.
Crazy.
Yeah, but he's number 13.
All these dudes wear number 14.
Yeah.
Cooks.
Not Hill.
He's
different.
He's a 10.
A 10.
Yeah, go back and check out our Tyreek Hill talk. But let's move on to Jarvis Landry. What do you got over there, Case?
Well, I guess just my number one question is why is everyone so mad at my guy Jarvis Landry? Could somebody fill me in on this? Is he just crushing everybody's wives or something? Like, what in the world is going on?
I'd let him have sex with my wife. I don't. People just want to hate. People are haters, man. People just want to be upset.
Trying to sort this mess out because I don't.
Aren't happy in their everyday lives. They just like to throw shade to make themselves feel better.
I mean, think that's it.
Maybe is it the metrics guys just really can't figure this guy out?
They don't want him to be good.
Well,
that's
he isn't
sure.
supposed to be good. How could it be? How is he doing what he should? He shouldn't be doing what he's doing right now.
Regression.
A dot. It's the A dot.
They don't know what to do with it.
They just can't figure this guy out. Or maybe it's just a bunch of dudes who got on board with Jarvis isn't any good out of the draft there, and I've just been just going down with the ship. I really can't tell you, but that's just more for us. I know everyone here is into him. Like, I'll take him wherever you guys don't want him, and I'll see you probably in the playoffs.
Right.
Because we talked about it with the other guys here. Like, he's averaging 15 points a game.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, the argument.
What else are you wanting out of the player that you, especially this year, because of the injury to Tannehill, everyone was like, oh, we don't know who it's going to be. Jarvis Landry dropped down in the rankings all of a sudden. So you got a diamond in the rough, maybe fourth, fifth round this year. I mean, usually he's hanging out in the third.
Yeah.
But I'll take him in any of those spots.
Exactly.
Well, the argument that's made for he's OSHA against
approved.
Him,
he is OSHA approved. Safety first.
He is safe.
Yeah, I mean so that's the argument against him in fantasy was that he's only good in fantasy because it was volume driven and that was definitely going to go down with Mr. Dink and Duck Tannehill not in there, right? And then the fact that Adam Gase offense supposedly doesn't need a slot wide receiver, like those are air quotes there. Mm-hmm. That was kind of a thing. And what did he do this year? Like he topped his best receptions, like which led the league at 112,
right?
Which bested his 111 a couple years ago. And like another knock is that he's never topped 5 touchdowns and that he doesn't score touchdowns. Well, then he goes out this year and gets 9 of them.
Yeah.
So you're telling me there's a dude here with the consistent 100 plus catches, 1,000 plus yards, and now his touchdown ceiling is on the rise? Like, sign me up. Like, can we all just jump on board? This dude is good. Like, the ADOT doesn't freaking matter, especially.
I'm sure there are certain times when it matters.
Especially but. If you're crushing Yak, which he's like 7th overall in the league with yards after the catch. He almost more than doubled his yardage with yardage after the catch. And he's up there in a list. There's only 2 wide receivers in the list of the top 7, and it's him and Golden Tate. And then it's like the best running backs in the league who crush right. Yak.
Well, me and Big Co have talked about this multiple times. He is a 2017 running back at the wide receiver position.
Right.
And just
runs nasty, angry, violent.
He's everything you want in his role. He is great at playing his role. He plays it to a T. And just like you said, the Yak is great. Like, he can move the chains for your squad. He can keep your squad on the field, therefore garnering himself more opportunities to get the football.
Right, right. Well, the thing about the... All right, let's go back to the ADOT for a second.
Can we not?
No, because the biggest thing about ADOT is the last part is target, okay? Mm. When you can talk about lack of average depth if you want to, but I want to talk about the targets. And Jarvis Landry is crushing targets.
Continually crushing targets.
Crushing receptions. And in the game that we play called fantasy football.
In PPR. In PPR. We should preface this whole conversation with PPR.
One of the Jarvis Landry.
PPR bust.
Jarvis Landry is probably the biggest mover. Him and Julian Edelman are the biggest movers in PPR. But, you know, and that stat comes across Twitter where Jarvis Landry is as his catches and his yardage total being right around 1,000 yards, and it had Julian Edelman and
Larry
Fitzgerald and just
seasons
that are very covetable in fantasy football.
Yeah.
So you got somebody like Jarvis Landry who's catching all this hate, but at the same time, all Jarvis Landry's doing is catching passes each and every week. He didn't have not 1 week this year, not 1 week in the season under 5 catches. So not 1 week in this season did
he leave
you.
Hey, I had that stat too.
He did not leave you under 10 points, not one single time. But here's what I really love about Jarvis Landry and his consistency. He had about the same amount, one more point for the year than Julio Jones, and they both averaged Jarvis Landry averaged 15.99 points a week. Julio averaged 15.9. We all know how frustrating it was to have Julio in our lineup every week this year. He had a 50-point game, bringing up that average to 15.9. But what I love about Landry is he didn't have one game over 22 points. It's not like he blew up 2 weeks for 30,
right,
and then every other week he had you guessing. Jarvis Landry put up 15.99 points on average every single week, and it was roughly right around there, 16 almost every week. He might have given you a 12 or 13, and he gave you an 18 or a 19, but he was giving you 16 points a week every single week, and that consistency, I got a couple teams with Landry, and when I'm putting my lineups together every single week, Landry does not have to move around. He's
right.
He's sitting up there.
You don't have to worry about the matchup. You don't have to worry about Homer away.
He's
blah,
moved
blah, blah, blah.
His way up out of my consistent in my teams with Landry last year. He was my number one flex option every week. Well, guess what he did this year? He goes up. He's my number one or number two wide receiver option every week. I'm not even flipping him around in my flex anymore. He's there for my team every single week. And like you were saying, it's basically an extended handoff. The way the NFL is moving, the way you want to try to run, some teams just need to move the chains.
Right.
Not everybody is going to be out there like Aaron Rodgers and throw 50-yard touchdown bombs and all that fine, and find Jordy somehow every week consistently. Landry was a safety net for a team that's had huge issues trying to move the ball. And that 15.99 points a week, that's top. I mean, to get out of that area, to get out of that average, you have to start talking about Odell Beckham, DeAndre Hopkins, and Antonio Brown are the only players that averaged anywhere above that 15. Even Keenan Allen and Larry Fitzgerald and Michael Thomas are at 16, which is 0.6 away from Jarvis Landry.
Right.
So give my man some respect, or like you said, stay off the wagon, and we'll keep drafting him.
Right. I'm fine with that. I mean, this is a guy who does everything you want him to do out of the slot position, and he probably could do more, but he plays his role to a T.
He plays his role.
And he's really hard to jam off the line. He's got extremely good balance. He's great after the catch. He's really hard to tackle. Like,
well, he's so feisty.
Right.
Like Byron Maxwell.
He just wants it more than you want it.
Right.
9 times out of 10.
Right. Byron Maxwell was saying on the top 100, I was watching Jarvis Landry's clip too. He said, one thing he always has on his mind that he's like always saying to himself is to kill everything moving.
Yeah.
Right? So that comes from like the Jay-Z Hard Knocks song where he's like, if my situation ain't improving, I'm about to murder anything moving.
Right.
And like that's his mentality in the open field is to run kind of violent.
He does.
But he also has like the juke and jive.
He's
like
got
he can
grace
stop
with
on
the
a
violence.
Dime.
Yeah.
Like there's literally times where I think he's like literally stopped to let a guy go by and then cut up the field. Like,
right.
Or he'll cut 5 times in a row if he has to, but he's just dancing around sometimes. But he can run you over.
And if you look at the metrics and all the stuff on Jarvis Landry's speed and all that other stuff, like
they don't jump off the page.
Nothing jumps off the page at you, but when
you
put
watch
the game
on the
tape
field.
On, it jumps off the page how quick and fast this guy actually
sure.
really is.
Right.
Yeah, and exactly. Let's put a bow on that part about the metrics and why Jarvis Landry, the metric people are like, he shouldn't be good. The metrics don't tell you anything about effort. And I like the metric people don't want to hear about effort. They don't want to talk about narrative. They don't want to talk about coaches. They don't want to talk about schemes. But here's what we got. We talked about wide receiver dependency and quarterbacks when we were talking about Stephon Diggs. Go back and check that out. What again, we're trying to score fantasy football points. We are playing a game, a made up game on a computer, based on a game that's awesome. Based on a real game. And this real game has 11 people fighting against 11 other people.
Right.
So there's 22 players running around cracking heads, all right? So we're trying to play a game on a computer off of this game, and there's not much you can really figure out about consistency in the NFL. And when you find somebody like Jarvis Landry that's going to consistently get you catches and touchdowns and points, and if it's – I don't care about the average depth of target.
Right.
Get that out of here. Landry's a good – there's nothing you can do. You can't come up with any. You can't tweak any numbers that tell me Landry's not a good football player.
Right, and I'm not mad at you. The metric people like some of that stuff.
I kind of am.
Some of that stuff's fun to look at.
I
and
love
it's a, and
stats.
It's an interesting thing. And you know, if things are really tight for you,
yeah.
And you're really like struggling to put this guy over this guy, and you see a metric that you like and you relate to, and you think that's you know that's fine if that's how you want to break your. Your close calls
sure.
and all that stuff, but you just can't. You can't just go out there and be like, "Oh, well, this here's what my computer and my algorithm says."
Right.
And all this other like, there's 22 guys on the field. There's so much imperfection going on. You just cannot control any of that.
You're dead right about that. And I've been guilty, especially the last couple of weeks, because some of it's starting to pile up and make me aggravated. But I've been guilty about just lumping all the metric guys together and finding out and telling you why it makes me mad. But you're right.
Tons of good metrics guys.
I'm not a big Twitter guy, but I will retweet something cool when I see it. I love a good stat. I love funky stats. Keep pumping them out. It's just don't use these funky stats as a way to be out.
As the gospel, Bo. It's the gospel.
Don't come at me.
Ain't Adam Schefter.
Don't take your game logs and your 40 speed and your targets and your depth that don't come up with some fancy algorithm that tell me the guy that's been in the top 24 of his entire career PPR points has only gotten better every single year and come out here and tell me he's not good.
Right.
Because your computer is broken.
Yeah.
Like, you know,
you're not accounting for things that you can't account for.
Right.
You've been hacked, Bo.
You got a virus.
It's just.
And it's Jarvis Landry.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Guys.
Nice. Same average of points as Julio Jones this year.
And Julio, like, and I don't want Julio Jones. I didn't want Julio Jones on my team this year because, like you said, he has these monster games, and then he kills you.
The volatility,
week in, week
the
out.
Volatility.
Jarvis
will make
gives
pull,
you
yes.
those 15 points actually every week.
Right,
kills you.
And that's why when we were talking about Tyreek Hill and Diggs, and I was like, if you put me on the clock right now, I might just have to take Landry.
Right. And the fact of the matter of that, you know, he was always a low touchdown kind of guy. This year you see him explode with touchdowns. Now maybe touchdowns are fluky, which is certainly you know, a thing. Touchdowns come and go or whatnot. But this, it always struck me as odd, just like a Diggs, just like all these other guys that we're talking about, but especially a Landry. This guy operates extremely well in a 10-yard window.
Yeah.
He should crush red zone targets. Yeah. Like, there's, I saw some, I don't even know who it was, but somebody was like, oh, Jarvis Landry is just relying on being schemed open. No, he's the exact opposite of that.
Right. They don't want to, like, Adam Gase is on record saying he's tried to scheme throws not to go to Landry, and Landry still gets the ball thrown at him because he's freaking open all the time.
Right. He's a new age.
He's the safety valve for a quarterback.
Any quarterback, not just Ryan Tannehill.
But that's what I'm saying. But who is Ryan Tannehill, right? And who is Ryan Tannehill's replacement? And who is the backup that
who cares?
Come in after
Landry
he got hurt?
Not, they haven't paid Landry. He might not even be in Miami. I don't care. Send him anywhere.
My point is, you got a guy like Julian Edelman whose name was made because of Tom Brady, and you got a guy whose name is Jarvis Landry who's done the exact same thing that we were praising
fawning over him.
We praised Edelman for what he could do catches-wise for our fantasy team, and now people want to throw tomatoes at Jarvis Landry. This man, you know why Diggs and Jarvis Landry and these cats haven't been really good in the red zone while they were 22, 23, 24 years old? Because when did you see a good efficiency rating in the red zone out of Ryan Tannehill and Sam Bradford and Case Keenum and whoever the hell else has been throwing these guys to football? The fact that these boys are doing what they're doing with below average quarterbacks only means to me that if somebody can grab a hold of a quarterback for one of these cats, their ceiling gets taller.
Yeah.
Like Jarvis Landry is out there catching balls, like you said, he's averaging 100 catches a year, and you can say that there's guy the other guy on the table is going to be like, well, he caught 100 balls because Ryan Tannehill had to throw him the ball.
Right.
Of course he did. But as a 22, 23, 24-year-old man, he's out there getting open in space against guys that want to take his head off, catching those passes from a below-average quarterback. And anything in the future above that is a bonus.
Yeah.
It's a bonus. Because
it's about to be.
It's about to be a bonus.
I don't think he'll be, I don't know that they'll – like, why wouldn't they have already extended him if they were going to keep him? So maybe he's somewhere else next year. I'd give it a better than 50-50 shot. So, I
wouldn't mind if I kind of want him to stay in with Adam Gase.
Like what Gase's got. If he'll stop.
He could obviously go somewhere else and crush, but I like his current situation.
I don't see how Miami lets him go. All that chatter in the offseason, and we got the guy behind you and whatever. We're going to replace Jarvis Landry. You know what? That didn't happen was Devontae Parker didn't become awesome.
Yeah, we're
still waiting on that.
Now, he did have a high ankle sprain.
Well, exactly.
I'm usually against the injury. Injuries here. I'm going to use that as defense for him.
Injuries
here.
And quarterback turnover and all that stuff, it just happens. Fantasy football is based on stuff that happens on a field with a bunch of guys running around trying to kill each other. So when you can find somebody like Jarvis Landry who stays healthy and catches balls for your fantasy team every week, put him on your team. Don't let him go. Don't trade him.
Maybe the 9 touchdowns are a fluky kind of thing, and maybe he goes back down to 4 or 3 again next year. Or maybe you just got a guy who works extremely hard because he wants to be better, wants to be the best, and you just saw an emergence of him just continuing to get better and better at perfecting his craft.
Right. I was watching him mic'd up on sound effects or whatever, and he's out there schmoozing it up with the refs. Like,
right.
Yeah. Hey, how's the wife and kids doing? You know, he's like,
talking to him throughout the game
about what they need to do in this offensive situation. And he's like, man, we need a touchdown here. And the ref's like, or maybe like a nice 6-minute drive. And he's like, yeah, that too. But he's just out there schmoozing refs so that he can maybe get a call, go his way at some point in the game for his team.
Mm-hmm.
He's smart. He will not be denied, and he wants to be the best. Like, he strives for that every day. It drives him. Like, watch interviews, you know, he comes from LSU, and he's got that Odell Beckham.
He wants to
be
better
the best.
Than Odell Beckham.
Right, right.
And we're boys.
Right. And like, I guess the only knock that you maybe could have on Jarvis Landry that I would listen to is that maybe sometimes he one-handed catches the ball when he might not need to.
Yeah, well.
Like, come on, you could have got two hands on that ball. But whatever, I mean, he makes a catch, right. So... And sometimes it comes in really handy when you're getting that hand pulled and you can do it with the other hand. You know, he's out there practicing that before the games and stuff.
I'm going to hammer it home again with you. I think that the tenacity and the way he plays this game after the catch and that balance that he has.
I think running back after he catches it, not something
that you can measure, and it's just he wants it more than you 9 times out of 10, and that's what makes him so good.
Yeah, well, you can measure it in yak yardage, and he had 511 of those.
Yeah.
So sign me up for Jarvis Landry. You don't want him. Ship him to me.
Yeah.
We'll take a couple miles. We'll take all the Jarvis Landry miles you got to offer, Bo.
We'll take a couple miles. All right. Miles.
Give me
I think that'll put a bow on Jarvis Landry. Let's get out of here. You've been listening to Married to the Game. All right. Welcome back, everyone. Be sure to hit us up on the social meds at the FF Dynasty, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, whatever your poison. We've been rambling on about these 11 through 13 ranked guys for us, and let's go ahead and we're going to try and wrap this up real quick with 14 to 15, just to, in case he's pretty anal, he wants that even odd five cutoff number here.
No, I'm just trying to watch this Chiefs-Titans game.
That's yeah. Yeah, well, we're going to go two more for your pleasure.
All right.
This is what we do for you.
Bring it.
Not you, the listener.
Let's do it.
Fuck about you.
Well, you right. Should.
Well, that's not very nice. I'm just kidding, man.
All right. Well, gosh. Number 14,
I just watched the Chappelle show last night, or the new Chappelle stand-up, so I'm a little feisty today.
Well, number 14 on our list also wears number 14, much like most of these guys on this 11 through 15 ranking here. Yeah. We got Brandon Cooks locked in at number 14 right now as our average ranking. Who wants to give us a little Cooks first here?
I'll step in on old Cooks. The volatility shows up a little bit more with Cooks than the guys we've been talking about. He's obviously a game breaker. He's got a 5 for 130 and 2, and he's got a 6 for 149 and a touch on his record this year. There was some, you know, he's got Tommy Brady throwing him the ball. We talked a lot about Cooks, about going from Breeze to Brady, and you don't go from Hall of Famer to Hall of Famer very often, quarterback change. So that was about as lucky as it could have gotten for a team that wanted to unload a receiver and try to improve their team. Speaking about the Saints. Mr. Cooks, he started the season a little slow, 3 for 88 and 2 for 37, and it was a little bit dicey. Then he blows up for the big game, and then a couple more games where it wasn't the best. His volatility is frustrating, to say the least, but his big game breakability, his ability to just pad up those stats, is just, you can't deny that. So it's
He's much like all these guys, where it's, you know, easy. All these guys are very similar. It's just one play to make your day for the most part, with the exception of possibly Landry in that group.
Right.
But he's going to have five plays that make your day. Like, yeah, you know, exactly. Five catches for 50 yards.
But again, it's funny. Like, a bunch of these guys are talking about their number on their jersey. They're all about 5'10", 190, 6 foot, 190. They're all about the same size. They've all burned fast, and they, you know, they
we're in the same numbers.
Play a little feisty, and they've made
crush crossing routes.
They've come in here and they've said, "Hey, I'm an NFL player, and you can't stop me." And Cooks is on this list. I think there's a reason that we have said that you could move these guys around all in order, but I think there's a reason that, you know, we put the Landry and we put the Diggs and we put the Tyreek Hill in front of Cooks. And to me, just personally, I have Cooks on a couple dynasty teams, and I enjoy his skill set, but it's just, to me, he's the most often put to the side guy. Like, for some reason, I don't know if it's recency biased in some of those last couple games where it was
three out of his last four fantasy weeks.
2 for 19, 1 for 38, 2 for 17. It just really put a sour to coming down the stretch where I had a team that really could have needed him. And that week 13 and 14 cost me a first round bye, and I ended up getting kicked out when I was one of the top teams in the playoffs and could have won a championship. It's the luck of the draw happens to you, and I caught the bad end of it. Maybe I got a rough taste in my mouth for Cooks. Dude's 24 years old. You know, you're going to have to find, you're going to have to search hard to find really negative stuff to say about Cooks. I just think he's behind Diggs and Landry, yeah. And for some of these reasons I'm trying to say here.
Yeah, I think with he has a potential to go anywhere on this list because he has that skill set. But this year it was kind of a lack of volume. Like, he only had, I think, 65 catches.
Well, his targets were right on par with last year. He was at 114 and 117 last year. So,
yeah, I mean, he's gotten up above 80, around 80 a couple times in his career. I mean, he still broke 1,000 yards, but I guess with his Patriots offense, he didn't come in and Randy Moss it. Like, they didn't absolutely have to get him the ball.
Right.
Like, they did scheme him, and they took their shots, and he drew a lot of pass interference calls, and he definitely helped this team win. And you have to respect him on defense because of that game-breaking skill. Bill Belichick loves him. He's singing his praises before they ever he was like, I'm glad I only had to play him once. Like,
right.
But
it's a good point. He did get a lot of flags. He moved the chains. 50.
Give me a point for a pass interference.
I know, right? He moved the chain. Every time I watch the Patriots play, I feel like he got a 40-yard pass interference call.
Right, right.
But that didn't give me 5 points for my team. That's a great point.
Right. It's a really strong point because, you know, you're playing against him or you're playing him and they're taking the shots and, you know, one out of three of them, he's getting a pass interference.
Yeah, right. And there's, if you look at the stats, he definitely had a drop down between the Saints numbers and what happened with the Patriots this year. And I think a lot of that does have, it wasn't the Patriots needed to, they didn't force him to ball. They didn't have to force him to ball.
There was also several plays that I can recall just thinking back where he probably could have scored a touchdown, but Tommy didn't quite put it out there all the way for him, and he had to come back and where he made plays, where he got five or six points.
And or it was batted down by the defender, but if it was thrown a little farther, he'd have had it.
Right. Yep. And so he missed out on some. Maybe Tommy's deep ball isn't quite where it used to be.
Mm-hmm.
And then I can't think of the guy's name who just came out with this report about how the Patriots are they're about to just disband and the dynasty's over and it's just ESPN looking for freaking clickbait.
There's turmoil in Patriot land now. I'm sure there's probably some truth to what's going on there.
Yeah, they're getting mad at how much money Tommy's making off this TB12 thing, and so they kicked his trainer out so that young guys don't have to come in there and be like, well, should I go with the team trainers or should I go with Tommy's trainer?
Well,
Tommy's 40 and in better shape than you are. Maybe they're lucky enough to have him around doing that kind of stuff. But
listen, it all has to come to an end at some point here. Maybe this is the end. Maybe they go for 10 more years, but this is almost unprecedented what the Patriots have been doing.
It is unprecedented.
And if this is how it ends, this is how it ends. Something's eventually going to give somewhere. Somebody's going to be unhappy with something. There's a power struggle somewhere. You've been winning for so long. Everybody thinks they're right.
And they just traded both of their backup quarterbacks,
which I think
been
is
the future.
What the disdain with Bill Belichick, at least reportedly, what the disdain with Bill Belichick and the rest of it. He's like, I wanted Jimmy.
Mm-hmm,
you always wouldn't let me keep Jimmy. You told me we had to trade him.
Yeah.
Right. So I don't know. Who knows? It's all whatever. But there is some turmoil in Patriot land over there, which also could subconsciously lead us to maybe bump Brandon Cooks a little bit down this list. He's a perennial, probably top 10, top 11 guy here in the last few years.
And see, that's part of the good. He's perennial top 10, top 12 PPR receiver, and he's 24 like that. And that's why you see him here, because the next guy we're going to talk about is T.Y. Hilton. And just to throw it in there, it's an age. Like these guys we've been talking about, they're so young and they've been so productive, and there's nothing that says they're not going to be good. It, you know, just so happened that Cooks comes in his first year, he's with Drew Brees and he's crushing and, you know, keeps it going. And I feel like I think Jay Wayne, you were going in the right direction there. I feel like the expectation when he went over the Tommy was that it would maybe go to another level. And the levels were good where he was at, because he was with Drew Brees in a high octane, this, you know, 5,000 yard Drew Brees for 5 years in a row kind of thing. Like you don't get better leaving Drew Brees, but I think we all expected maybe, hey, let's see a Randy Moss. And Randy Moss is Randy Moss and nobody else is Randy Moss.
Yeah.
And this dude's 5'10", 190, not 6'4".
And you got Brady in his prime and all that.
Right.
Other,
and Brady's definitely not in his prime now. But he is still they're doing work, and I don't doubt that we can just line Brandon Cooks up for another 15 average per catch and a ton of catches and a ton of yards and he's
decent ceiling of touchdowns,
exactly,
a floor of touchdowns.
I think
seven this year.
I think
could have had more.
If you're on the clock and you're looking at Brandon Cooks, I think you have a safe asset. It's just There is question marks, and everything y'all just said about the Patriots, and you know, I don't think
Tommy could ride out
but
at the end of this
as
year.
As we sit here today, January 6th, and the Patriots have a first round bye in the playoffs, they could win it all and he could ride off into the sunset, or they could lose and he could just be frustrated and not want to play with these guys. You know, the dynasty, like you said, the dynasty is set in stone, and nobody can take away how great the Patriots have been, and it has to come to an end at some time or another. If it happens this year, next year, what happens to Brandon Cooks, because they don't have Jimmy G and they could be starting over if Brady's not there. And, you know, I want to stay away from the ifs and all this stuff, but, you know, there's a lot to be played out for the rest of the year for the Patriots, and it could go a bunch of different directions.
Right.
But,
and we could sit here and say what we want about him, but we're still talking about him in this top 15 of wide receivers. And like you said,
I also think
you have a safe asset with him. Maybe he's not, you know, crushing like you want him to crush per se, I guess, but I mean he was really just fine this year. It, you know, he hurt you a little bit at the end of the season, but I mean 65 catches, 16.6 average yards per catch and seven touchdowns. I mean, this yeah. is, and a young man who
in a new offense.
Exactly.
Right, who's
that's well that's good that's
first
good point.
Year in that offense is a tough offense to learn.
Good point.
He definitely didn't do anything to lower his stock. I just think maybe this we just don't know what's going to happen next year, right. I guess. I wouldn't imagine they're all not back, but I guess if they win the Super Bowl, I could see them just being like, "You know what? Let's just drop this mic."
No, good point there. Brandon Cooks didn't do anything this year to lower his stock, and he's right around about the same spot he was last year, maybe two clicks lower for most people, but that's because people came in and played their way in front of him, you know.
Right.
There's nothing that Brandon Cooks did. Like, and part of the problem is because you saw those flags and you're it leaves you wanting more. It's you're frustrated because maybe the ball was a little shorter and he had five steps on the defender, but you know, it just didn't get there. Or maybe he was there and the ball was coming in and he just gets yanked down by the defender. Like, there was so many times when I watched the Patriots play with those flags, and mm-hmm. it just really aggravates you. But I didn't even put that, you know, new system. Just because you go to play with Tom Brady don't mean you come in knowing the plays.
Right, or can even make it on the field off the rip. So kudos to him for doing that.
James White and Deion right. Lewis.
I was just about
Rex
to bring
Burkett,
that up. All these running backs
they
just catch the shit out of
the
ball.
They crush the interior passes. And when Edelman went down, that's what everybody thought was Brandon Cook's huge stock up.
Mm-hmm.
And it would just – and it Chris Hogan to start the season was absolutely on fire. And the way that offense is run and the way they've put it together the last couple years as it's like just protect Brady. Nothing else matters because we're going to win the game. We're solid. We're the best coach team in NFL, probably NFL history. So as long as we just get the ball out quick and don't let Brady get hit, we're going to just try to make the playoffs. We're going to be the number one seed and go try to get another ring.
Yeah.
That's what it's about. It's not about anybody's stats.
Right.
And so Cooks is the outside in looking. He's got a great season, but it's just a little tainted.
A healthy Chris Hogan. I mean, Chris Hogan was a top 10 receiver for
killing
six
it.
Weeks there. So it's, you know, there's a good it's for Brandon
so
Cooks to be
around.
As high. Yeah, exactly. That's kind of what I was
only one football.
Driving out there.
You usually hear that in basketball where there's only one ball. Right. But in Patriotsville, Brady's going to get the ball out quick. They're going to use the quick passes like a running game. And then this year with all the running backs that they had, and they ended up all staying pretty much healthy, then they just you know, dominated teams.
And a healthy Gronk, like Jason said.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, that was some Brandon Cooks. For your pleasure. Well, let's take it to the guy ranked 15th in our overall dynasty wide receiver rankings to this point. T.Y. Hilton had a down year. Nobody saw this Andrew Luck thing coming out of nowhere. We thought he might miss a few games. They didn't put him on the PUP list. We were like, all right. And then all of a sudden they trade for Brissett, and that's pretty much history. And now there's even cloud moving forward on whether Andrew Luck, which I'm sure he's probably going to be just fine. I think he went over to Europe, got some stem cell rejuvenation done. Hopefully that shoulder is good to go and he doesn't need any more surgery. But for the year that T.Y. had, which he didn't crack 1,000 yards, he only had four touchdowns, 57 catches, certainly not up to T.Y.'s standard and average. And it warrants dropping him a few spots here, I think. And it also, we mentioned it a little bit before where he's 28. And you look at these rankings and you see all these young dudes. We just talked about all these super young dudes. And now T.Y.'s there at 28. Sometimes that's enough for people to just be out and they don't want the age, but I mean that's dumb. Don't be like that. But it does drop him down here to 15, but I mean he's still a great player.
Well, and you could be playing into some more, again, subconscious kind of recency bias about, you know, what T.Y. Hilton did, and like you said, there's questions at the quarterback positions, there's questions at the coaching position here.
Right.
There's questions
ownership.
from an organization standpoint, the Colts are just miserable.
I mean, Indianapolis
right now.
Is suspect in general.
Yes,
the city.
It's just very suspect city in general.
Indy 500 is freaking awesome, but outside of that.
But, you know, you had T.Y. had glimmers and glimpses this year of what he does for you. But, it, you know, you weren't getting your standard T.Y. season out of him this year. And it's a little bit of a bummer. But you would imagine he'll bounce right back as if Luck comes back and should come back. I believe he'll be
right.
All right. You go get a little stem cell action, like you said. And
work for Kobe Bryant.
Should be good to go.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, you know. Well, the age thing is an easy reason, and the recency bias, both easy reasons to bump this guy down at the even 15 here, and he could easily be back up in 9, 8, 7, really, you know, if he wanted to.
If Luck came back and crushes next year, yeah, he could jump up.
No doubt.
Definitely into the top
10. And the dude just turned 28 in November. He did just turn 28. So it's easy to look at 28 versus 24 on another guy and be right. Like, oh, that's a huge difference. But, you know.
28.1.
And some of these other guys we were talking about, their feistiness and their ability to, you know, play through contact and just, you know, see them get gimped up and they come back on the field. Well, T.Y. Hilton's 5'9", 178, soaking wet, but he's missed two games in his entire career.
Solid okay? stat.
So this man is out there playing. Casey and I were talking the other night on the phone about these guys, and like T.Y. Hilton is not your Tyreek Hill where he's going to be running a bunch of jet sweeps and returning punts. But when T.Y. Hilton is out there and got a quarterback that can hit him accurately, a lot of times when he catches a pass, he doesn't even get touched. He's so fast and so slippery. He's one of the most elusive guys, and is you don't really even see him having to juke people because he's joystick fast.
When he gets the ball in his hands and the camera sees him, he had already done his dirty work, so you don't even see that half right. the time because he's just three steps ahead of the guy when he catches
T.Y.
it.
T.Y. Hilton is ridiculous.
Let me get that sky cam all the time.
And it was a huge drop-off in numbers this year. He's coming off of a 91 catch, 1,450 yard. He led the league in receiving the year before last.
Yep.
Yeah. You know? Andrew Luck literally wore his shoulder out throwing it to him.
Right.
Right. He needed surgery.
Yeah, so the T.Y. Hilton, the love for T.Y. Hilton you have to drop him down a list a little bit, but you need to love what he's done and what he can still do. This cat is a ridiculously good football player. And just like everything you just said, Jay Wayne, if you had any inclination of the Luck injury being as bad as it was, you would have not had T.Y. Hilton ranked in the top 10 of wide receivers last year. But you did have him ranked there because he had earned it. And there's a lot of ups and downs in this game, and a lot of people, you know, you're lost seasons. And look what Todd Gurley did this year after having just mm-hmm. a horrible season the year before.
Sure.
So the Colts, I think down to most men on the team didn't realize what was going on with Luck. And it just – the tires fell off. And the only thing that – they can be excited about is the fact that they picked up Brissett for really cheap and he actually looks like a decent quarterback. I was very impressed. You got to imagine Brissett goes over there to a team who, when Peyton Manning left, they were bad enough to earn the first pick in the draft. The timing was everything for them to pick up Luck. Luck goes out. They got no good. They have hardly.
They had one. They played one game with
Tolzien
as the starter.
I think they had negative yards. I think they had negative yards with Tolzien.
Whole team's gonna quit if this keeps up, man. So nobody's going something. Out on the field. Yeah.
Nobody's taking the field. So they bring in Brissett mid season, and he comes out there and he looks legit. So there's
mid preseason, right?
Week two. Wow. Mid-season, and Brissett comes out there, and he looks like a legit quarterback. So, obviously, you're thinking that, you know, the owner of the Colts, who none of us believe anymore at this point, but he says Luck will be out there playing, and he's staying on the team. So, the upside is T.Y. Hilton gets Luck back next year, and he crushes again, and that's what we hope for. But you have to knock him down the list due to age, like we said, and just the question marks about the guy tossing him the ball. And the rough part is I could see another season of, what's going on with the Colts over there situation. Maybe Luck doesn't come back super healthy. You got to start thinking about that. And if it gets any farther down the line and there's any more clarity on the potential for just another horrible season for the Indianapolis, then maybe T.Y.'s value continues to drop down the board and he becomes a huge value because he's not slower. He doesn't not catch everything that comes his way. He's not bad at football.
No.
He's the most dependent player on the field for everybody else. Right. He's the number one receiver in this offense. Look at Dante Moncrief. What's he done? Nobody other than Jack Doyle, which is a new quarterback's best friend, nobody did anything on the Colts this year at all. Lost
horrible
season.
Offensive line.
Lost season.
Receivers all over the place.
Yeah.
So and we talked about at the beginning of this whole podcast about how this is a very and middle. This is a codependent situation here, and you know, really to have Brissett throwing in the ball, a guy who literally got there in the middle of the season and knows nothing, he still finished as the top 30 receiver.
Yeah,
I mean, you know,
average 17 yards a catch.
You could have been using him all year long for the most part.
There were games where you had, I mean, there was a I remember specifically he had been on my bench for 2 or 3 weeks in a row, and then they come home. Brissett had looked good the week before, and I got him at a good home game against a weak defense, and he got me like 28 or something. It was hard. So, a lot of these numbers came in 1 or 2 games because just it was a hard season for him, and it's just nowhere to put a bow on it.
Guys like T.Y. and a lot of these guys that we have talked about at times can be rather boom or bust, and the reason that we like some of these other guys above him is because we think some of that boom or bust is taken out because they can do some other things. But with T.Y., like, you kind of, the ranking was, it was really high coming into the season because it was finally, all that had been removed. He had 90 catches. There was no more like games where it was like, oh, well, he had 2 for 20.
Good point.
You know?
Good point.
So
that's exactly what happened. And then this year with the terrible situation, look, 7 for 153 and a touch against Cleveland. The home game I was just talking about that happened was they went up to Seattle and didn't play good, but Brissett looked like a legit quarterback, and I was like, oh my god, they got Brissett, good for the Colts. He comes back home and plays against the Niners, 7 for 177. Later in the season, he goes 5 for 175 and 2 against Houston, which came out of nowhere.
Yeah,
like there's a bunch of 2 for 15s and 1 for 19s on this list, but when it happens big for T.Y. because again, it goes, he's top shelf upside. And what happened in 2016 is exactly what Casey just said. He ironed out the floor, and he and Luck were on the same page, and he got 90. Yeah. There were
Everyone
no more
was like,
2
oh, well,
20.
I'm all in now that I can get 91 receptions.
If you take the 2 for 20 off the board, which is exactly what Landry has, off hit, that 2 for 20 is not even out there for Landry. Those are that your safety. You pull that floor up, and you keep a high ceiling like T.Y., and that's why he's top 10 last year. 5 for 75 and 2, like not many players can ever get those types of games, and those happen all the time for T.Y., and he's just had a bunch of really bad games this year. And with a ridiculously bad offense. It's a
terrible situation.
In a spot where their defense could literally come out there and be like, just bracket T.Y. Don't give up the big play, and we're going to win. It's the Colts.
Yeah.
So the T.Y. Hiltons of the world need to have Luck come back healthy and see what happens next year.
All right. Well, that'll put a bow on our 11 through 15 wide receiver rankings.
Way too early wide receiver rankings.
Yeah, it's a bit premature, but I mean, I feel pretty good about this order. I mean, it was a solid order.
Yeah, sure.
Could shuffle. We got free agency, the draft, all kind of stuff to come. But this is a good exercise. It's fun. It's fun to look into these guys. Been kind of like going nonstop with rookie tape lately. It was nice to break away from that and get back to like real
NFL.
Yeah,
back to guys who are playing.
So stay tuned for the rookie talk coming up in the near future. If you guys have any questions or want to hit us up on the socials, you can find us at the FF Dynasty, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, for your pleasure. Also, be sure, if you enjoyed anything about the show today, please give us a 5-star review on iTunes, preferably. Hit subscribe on your platform of choice, iTunes, Podbean, Stitcher, Google, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio. Please and thank you. Till next time, you've been listening to the FF Dynasty's Nasally Married to the Game.